we pray our holy God this day. As we introduce ourselves to one another today, I'm going to ask you to think about and maybe ask each other, who's the best listener in your life? I hope you have a good listener. Who's the best listener in your life? Let's greet one another. See who's listening to me at this point. I invite you to stay standing. Stay standing as we continue our call to worship. Join me in our call to worship. From our cluttered lives to your spacious presence, gracious God, we gladly come. From our noise-filled world to your quiet center, gracious God, we gladly gather. From our time-bound days to your timeless calm, gracious God, we gladly meet. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal God of all time and all places, we praise you. Amen. You may be seated. I'll invite Jackie to come forward as our reader today.
As usual. Reading from Acts 3, verses 1 through 10. Peter and John were going up to the temple at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, the established prayer time. Meanwhile, a crippled man since birth was being carried in. Every day, people would place him at the temple gate, known as the Beautiful Gate, so he could ask for money from those entering the temple. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he began to ask them for a gift. Peter and John stared at him. Peter said, "Look at us." So the man gazed at them, expecting to receive something from them. Peter said, "I don't have any money, but I will give you what I do have. In the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, rise up and walk." Then he grasped the man's right hand and raised him up. At once his feet and ankles became strong. Jumping up, he began to walk around. He entered the temple with them, walking, leaping, and praising God. All the people saw him walking and praising God. They recognized him as the same one who used to sit at the temple's beautiful gate asking for money. They were filled with amazement and surprise at what had happened to him.
So I have a special box today. I haven't had it for a long time, so I am going to invite these two lovely women in front here to let us all know what's in the box. So what do you see here?
I see scissors.
Scissors, there's a pair of scissors.
A pen.
A pen.
Paperclip.
A paperclip.
A calculator.
Calculator.
Earbuds.
Earbuds. Thank you very much. Okay. Did everybody hear that? I'm going to take one of these items away. And now I'm going to tell you what's in here, and you tell me what's missing. Pair of scissors, earbuds, calculator, and paper clip. A pen. Excellent. We'll try it one more time. I'm going to take something different away. I have here left a calculator, a pen, a paper clip, and some earbuds. What's missing?
Scissors.
Scissors. And I almost killed myself because of that. Right. Very good. I don't know how many of you used to play this game or something similar like this when you were younger or at baby showers or wedding showers, right? And the idea is, how much are you noticing? How much are you really paying attention, right? So in the reading that we just heard that Jackie read, it's talking about how Peter and John, when they come in, they see this man at the side asking for money, and they notice him. I'm going to charge us all in my sermon today, like, to think about, who do we notice, and are we being noticed? What does that feel like when we are noticed? So let's fold our hands and say a prayer. Dear God, we give thanks that you see us. You know us as your own. Help us to see others. Amen. So our gospel reading today is from Mark chapter 6, verses 53 to 56. When Jesus and his disciples had crossed the lake, that's Lake Galilee, they landed at Gennesaret, anchored the boat, and came ashore. People immediately recognized Jesus and ran around that whole region, bringing sick people on their mats to wherever they heard he was. Wherever he went, villages, cities, or farming communities, they would place the sick in the marketplaces and beg him to allow them to touch even the hem of his clothing. Everyone who touched him was healed. So, of course, our gospel reading comes from before Easter, before the crucifixion and resurrection. But here in the book of Acts, the first reading, it's immediately after Easter. And so we're thinking about, what do you do when you're Jesus' disciples, followers, and Jesus is no longer with you anymore? How are they going to carry on the ministry? So that's the context of our reading today. You know, on Easter Sunday, some of you that were at this service, at the 11 o'clock service, saw that Rita Colombo was here. She's been a longtime member of the congregation, and she gave me permission to share this story with you all. So, of course, Rita's had some medical problems the last few months, so this is the first time we've seen her since before Christmas. And so when she was here, I went up to her and I said, Rita, so good to see you. Her response was, it's good to be seen. It's good to be seen. And I realized after she said that's not the first time I've heard her say that. I think I see some nods around here that you have heard her say that as well. And I'm not exactly sure when she started to say that, it's good to be seen. But I know I've heard from a lot of people as we get older, that sometimes it feels like we're not seen as much. We don't have as many people notice us or pay attention to us. And it's good to be seen. I've also heard from women or younger workers or people of color in the workplace when there's a meeting and they have this idea that they think is great and they share it. It seems people don't hear it until someone else shares that same idea. Maybe someone that has more authority in the group. We all like to be seen for ourselves, right? When I lived in Seattle, the church that I served had a homeless shelter every night in the basement of the church. And I remember speaking to one gentleman there, and what he said is, you know, I don't mind if people walk by and don't put money in the cup when I have it out there. He said, but couldn't they at least say good morning? Couldn't they see me as a fellow human being? That certainly touched me Because I know from my standpoint, sometimes I don't always give to the person who's asking, and I'm kind of embarrassed that I don't. So I walk away, pretend maybe that I don't see them. But after talking to this gentleman, I make a point of saying at least good morning to people that I see. Most of us want to be seen. So today we have the story in the book of Acts, and Jesus' disciples, the Holy Spirit has come and has empowered them to do ministry. But as I mentioned before, now they have to decide, but what does that ministry really look like for us? And so they start doing something that they always do. They went to the temple. At that time in Jewish history, in Jewish faith life, there were two prayer times every day. And faithful Jews would go to the temple for communal prayers and offer sacrifices of some sort, morning and afternoon. So as this story in the book of Acts begins, it's the afternoon prayer time called the Minha. And Peter and John are on their way into the temple, but before they get there, they pass through this gate. And no one really knows why, but it's called, we get the specifics, it's called the Beautiful Gate. So I imagine it was probably quite nice gate, right? And there outside of the gate is a man, and he's unable to walk. He's been carried there by some friends. I wonder if this scenario sounds a little bit familiar to some of us. Do you remember the story of another man who couldn't walk, but he had some friends? And his friends brought him through the roof to see Jesus. So I wonder if Peter and John are saying, we're to continue Jesus' ministry. I remember what Jesus did when he met the man that couldn't walk. And so they stop and they see this man who has friends, that every day we're told, these friends go to his house, pick him up, carry him to the temple, put him where he will ask for money throughout the day. And then, at the end of the day, however long it takes, they take him back again, carry him back home. What some wonderful friends that do that. Who knows how long they've done that for? We're told that he hasn't been able to walk since birth. And of course, this is a logical place to ask for money. Throughout scriptures, the prophets have said over and over again that God's desire is not our worship and sacrifice if we don't take care of the needs of those who are in need. Look first to the people around us, God says in Amos and in Micah. Look at that. Care for those in need, and then that is your worship. So Peter and John walk to the temple. And they see this man outside. It's good to be seen. And of course, this is an honor-shame culture. And people back at that time, many believed that illness or disability was your own fault, that you messed up somehow. So perhaps the man doesn't feel like he can look up at them. But they stop in front of him, Peter and John, and they say, "Look at us. Look at us." And they look him in the eye as he is the beloved child of God that he is. They connect as human beings, one to each other, both beloved children of God, both equal in God's eyes, both with something to give each other. In about another month, it's hard to believe that it's coming so soon, but 16 of us are traveling to this small village, Rohanga, in Zimbabwe. Yeah, wow. It's the village where Ramson Gimbiza, one of our members, grew up, and for 20 years, this congregation has a relationship with Rohanga. I actually saw that this week. It was 2004, the first time that the congregation worked with the village of Rwanda. And so what this congregation has done over the years is purchase a grinding mill so that the women who would normally have to walk half a day to get their corn ground could just do it right in the village. This church has also provided school fees. It costs money to go to school in Zimbabwe, and that allowed children to go to school. We've purchased toiletries and food and building supplies, particularly during the pandemic in this very rural village where it was hard to get anything. Transportation was a problem all around the world, but can you imagine being in this small rural village? You were the last that people thought about. So through this time, we've done many things together. And when you are living so far away from the village, when you've never actually met anyone aside from Ramson from the village, you've never been there yourself, it's easy to see problems in the village, but not people. And so one of the gifts that Ramson has shared with us is on this trip, we will see the people. The most important thing that we will do is meet people, share each other's lives, develop relationships, laugh, talk, converse, maybe dance with each other. We will be in relationship with each other. We will see them, and they will see us. I was reminded of another story of how it's good to be seen. When our confirmands this week, we served a meal on Monday night at Bread and Roses in Lawrence. And we learned that most of the people that come to Bread and Roses to receive a meal in the evening go through the takeout line. It's faster. If they have family at home, they can get it quickly and go back home. But about 30 people chose to come inside, sit at a table, and have a meal. Each person had a placemat and real silverware. And so they were invited in and to have a seat, and then our confirmation students would take the plate of food, and one-on-one, they would place it in front of the guest on the placemat. It's like a restaurant, even. That one-on-one relationship helps each to be seen. Each to be seen as a human being worthy of dignity and honor just for being themselves. It's good to be seen. Every week at Holy Communion, we come up and we receive the body and blood of Jesus Christ. And one of the things that Martin Luther said that I share as much as I can is that in the sacrament of Holy Communion, Luther said the most important words that you hear is, "This is for you. The body and blood of Christ is for you." We all need to hear that for ourselves. God's mercy and love and grace and forgiveness is for you. We receive God's love, we receive God's presence in the bread and wine, and then we rise. We go out and we see other people. Really see them. My challenge for us this week is to notice someone you might have not noticed before. Do you really see the person who takes your recycling every couple of weeks? Do you really see the person who is behind the grocery counter? It's good to be seen. We are seen. Let us see others. Amen. I invite you to stand as together we sing.
Thank you.
you to join me as together we affirm our faith. We believe in God, the Creator, maker of everything, author of the universe, and mystery behind every matter. We believe in Jesus Christ, God from God, light from light, true God and true human, one with the Creator. He is the Word made flesh and the Savior of all creation. We believe in the Holy Spirit, breath of God moving among us, one with the Creator and one with Christ. He is our guide and the mentor of all creation. Let us pray. The world we bring in prayer to you is marked by needs we see and hear, in broken lives where illness, grief, or tragedy can strain the strands of hope. God of grace, hear our prayer. The world we bring in prayer to you is marked by deeds we see and hear in generous lives, where love, mercy, and compassion strain the claim so often voiced that you cannot be or cannot be love. God of grace, hear our prayer. The world we bring in prayer to you knows sorrows and knows joys. Weeping with the weeping and rejoicing with the rejoicing is your call to us, a measure of our care, a pattern for our love. We pray we leave no sorrow unaccompanied, leave no joy unshared. God of grace, hear our prayer. We pray that we take the time to look and to listen, that crying hearts are heard, physical needs are seen, and all know their worth to you is priceless. God of grace, hear our prayer. We pray for the concerns and celebrations named by this community today. Especially we pray for Rita, for Phil, Renita, Chris and Amy, and Ken. We pray for Marianne Karp and family upon the death of Ed this morning. We pray for diplomacy to prevail in the Middle East, a release of hostages. We pray that humanitarian aid be released in Gaza and that there be an end to warfare. We pray for the victims and survivors of the attack in Australia this week. We pray for runners that are preparing to run the marathon tomorrow. We ask for their safety and health, and ask that their friends and families may cheer them on, and it may be a joyous time for all. Into your hands, most merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abiding love, through Jesus Christ, our resurrected and living Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Is there someone that would pass the offering plate for us this morning? Thank you, John. As we receive our financial gifts, we will sing a musical gift.
Calling out, light the fire again. Don't
stand as you're able. Let us pray. You promise, Lord Jesus, to come to us in a new way, your Spirit leading us in your way. May we now rededicate ourselves to that way, giving of all we can, as we are able, of our time, talents, and treasure. Use us in your service, God of promise. Amen. In the waters of baptism, we receive God's love and forgiveness and are forever connected to Christ. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. At the beginning of time, your Spirit moved over the waters, your word calling out into the deep and creating everything there is. Your Spirit continues to move through the story of your people, crossing the Red Sea with Moses and the Israelites, delivering them into safety, sweeping across the lands in the great flood, making way for a new beginning when all seemed lost, washing over us in the waters of baptism, making us new. In these waters, we hear God proclaim, "You are my beloved," and that is our truth forever. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Wherever you are in your faith journey, you are welcome to the table for Holy Communion. For those of you at home, please hear these words for you. The body of Christ is given for you. The blood of Christ is shed for you. For those of us here in person, we'll go from the front to the back. You'll be invited to either stand or kneel around the communion table. I will place a wafer into your hand, and I also have gluten-free wafers, if that is your preference. And Corrine has a tray that has red grape juice or white wine. You may take a cup and consume it, and then place it in the empty tray and return to your seats. Come to the table. Please stand as you're able. Into the healing presence of God we entered. Refreshed and restored, we now prepare to leave this place, ready to serve. Amen. May the God of resurrection power, the Christ of unending joy, and the Spirit of Easter hope bless you now and always. Amen. Let us sing.
Now, our drummer is out of town today, you may have noticed. So you guys have your own instruments. So if you feel like clapping along, please do. It's perfectly okay.
Let the walls fall down.
and share a little bit more about our Zimbabwe trip.
So yeah, in a couple of weeks, on May 14th, we're going with a total of 16 people are going to Zimbabwe. It's a long trip. I mean, I think I counted up 18 hours of plane, plus other stuff, van ride and everything, to get to Ramson's village. Ramson was at our first service. You all have seen him. So we're doing a lot of, we're planning a lot of things at the village. But one of the things that we're working on is a youth center. So we decided to try to fund and build a youth center for the about 300 children that live in the village. And through the donations of everybody over the years, we have the online donations. We've been able to fund a lot of the materials that are required. All the labor is being donated for free, including labor that we're going to give. But we're still in need of some funds to put the roof on. So we have this new drive called Raise the Roof. We're looking to get up to $1,500, and there's lots of ways to give. Out in the narthex, there's a video screen. There's a QR code that comes up every once in a while. The QR code is right there. We also have the online giving area. And there's envelopes out in the narthex that you could put some money in. So we really appreciate it if you could help us to get to that goal. Just wanted to end a little bit to give a little bit of personal note about like what I'm expecting or what I'm going to get out of it. Since I've been back at Faith for almost 20 years, known Ransom ever since we came back here, we've got to know his family. We know Anna Sue. We know Fozzie. We know T. We've spent a lot of different occasions with their family. Even got to meet Ramson's mom one winter. She was surely cold. She was here in the wintertime, and she was like, I don't know why I'm here. But I guess it was to see her family. But, you know, as Pastor Jim was saying, I'm really looking forward to meeting the people in the village and to getting to just, like, be with them, to experience their life, and to just, like, spend almost 2 weeks and to get to know a totally different culture, a totally different way of life, and that'll be exciting. Over the next couple weeks, you're going to hear other people who are going to talk about the Raise the Roof campaign, but also to give you a little bit more information about the events, and if you want to talk to us about that, we'd be happy to share with you other things we're going to do.
Thank you, Mark. A couple other things to draw your attention to. So this Wednesday, we have Pub Spirituality at Palmer's Restaurant and Tavern, 6:30 on Wednesday. And the topic of conversation is going to be about how nature connects to our faith. So it'll be a conversation then. And then our lunch bunch meets this Thursday at 11:30 at Kitty's in North Reading. An old-time favorite. My aunt and uncle went on their first date there. Must have been like 60 years ago. I don't know. So an old favorite if you want to try it or for the first time or for the first time in a long while, 11:30 on Thursday. Are there other announcements for today?
I would just like to invite you, and I know I do this every so often, if you'd ever like to come sing with us or if you know an instrument that you'd like to play with us, let me know. It doesn't have to be on a weekly basis. It could be once a month, could be whenever you're available, but I'd just like to remind everybody that this is an option. Contact me via email, or I think my phone might be on the church's website. I don't know my email. So anyway, but just talk to me afterwards.
Very good. And then also a reminder that our RIC speaker who is here between services is still here, Pastor Cliff Gerber, who knows a little bit about the history of becoming a welcoming congregation, LGBTQIA+, in our area and in the Synod. And so he's willing to speak to stay after this service and continue the conversation in the Sunday school classrooms. So check that out. Let us go in peace.